What do you see? How many of you see a vase? How many of you see two faces? Yeah, how is it that some of us can see one thing and some of us see something completely different? It drives me nuts when you go to these theme parks and they have these illusions and you have to stare at it for like 5 to 10 minutes and just try to make it out, to try to figure it out. It's almost like the same way in our Christian faith. You got some people that believe in one thing. They see one thing. They know it. They believe in it with all of their hearts. And you got other people that say, absolutely not. I don't see it. I'm staring at it. I'm reading this book. I'm reading the scriptures. And I just don't see it. And then you got some of us that are in between, in the middle. And I hope to be able to spell out some of this stuff for you. Let's talk about the Bible. We got this book, the Bible. And there's three things that we really need to analyze to see, is this Bible actually true? You put it through the test of time, and there's really three questions that we ask. The first one is, how many documents? What is the amount of documents that actually speak about this message of the Bible? The second thing is, when was the Bible actually written? What was the time gap between the story of what it actually took place and when it was actually recorded? Have you ever played the game telephone with somebody? We all know it as kids, right? Kids, you guys played the game telephone, you know, for the younger ones in here. And they actually whisper from ear to ear to ear, and by the time it gets to somebody, it's a completely different message. We do that with gossip all the time, by the way, as adults. You know, we say something and then it changes over time and we say something else. Oh, do you know what I heard? And it gets to the point that the story is completely different than what it started out to be. We play that. And so the Christians that studied this word for the first 2,000 years, and even today scholars, they say, what was the time period? What was the time gap between the time period that the story of Jesus Christ actually took place and when it was actually recorded down? And then number three, what is the accuracy within it? So we're going to study those three things this morning with that. The historical document. In Matthew 5:18, it says, "For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or stroke shall pass from the law until all is accomplished." You see, even in the Bible it says that this is accurate. Matthew had to make a case to the Pharisees and to the people, the Jews of that time, that this story that I'm recording of Jesus Christ is actually accurate, because they believe something totally different. It's just like the movie In God's Not Dead, where the professor believed that God was dead and Josh Wheaton is making the case. Matthew is recording in this book a story, and we call it the Gospel of Matthew. And he's recording a historical account of the 3 years that he walked with Jesus Christ. And when he walked with Jesus Christ, he saw miracles. He saw all these different things happen. And he begins to write them down in order to make a case that, yes, Jesus was God. He was king. And he died and resurrected for our sins. And so, but people say, how do we know that Matthew's actually correct? How do we know historically it's actually correct? And so, just to let you know, if you're taking notes, within your bulletins, there's a section to take notes. Write this down. Take a pen, write this down. There are over 5,664 Greek manuscripts that actually talk about our Bible. In fact, there's 19,000 copies in various other languages besides Greek, for a total of our manuscripts of 24,600. Over 24,600 manuscripts talk about the stories within our Bible. And we don't ever debate some of the other things that we've heard within history. In fact, there's 20 copies or less of documents of ancient history with Plato, Caesar, Herodotus. There's only 193 documents that Aristotle has, and we don't debate those at all. Yet we're willing to debate 24,600 manuscripts that actually talk about the Bible. Number two is, what was the actual time period that it was written? We have the entire New Testament written within the first 70 years of Jesus' life. When Jesus actually resurrected and ascended into heaven, they went to work. And within 70 years of time period, they actually wrote our Bible. However, we never debate manuscript copies or the original of Homer's Iliad, which was written 500 years after the story actually took place. In John 18, it's actually believed that it was written within 25 years of the original document from when the time period actually happened. And so they've dated these. So we're not debating 500 years, but we're debating 25 years. So our Bible actually has a shorter amount of time from the story that actually took place, which means it should be more accurate. It has more manuscripts even outside of it that's talking about it than any other document. And then number three, the New Testament actually has been shown to be 99.5% accurate. 99.5%. Now you say, well, what about the other 0.5%? What about the 0.5%? Well, they give 0.5% for spelling errors when we do reprints or verses that have been reversed within. And so you have two sentences within a chapter of Mark 18, and they reverse these two sentences around. They put the second part first and the first part second, and they've made mistakes. And so they give error for that, but they've actually said it's 99.5% accurate. In our Old Testament, we used to have these dated documents that we could only go back 1,000 to 1,000 AD of the Old Testament. Because what would they do? They would write, they would record this. They would record it on papyrus paper, and they would record it all down. And over a time period, what happens is things start to break apart, right? So we have the Old Testament documents, and they decompose, and they break apart. But we had these scribes that were writing it over and over and over again, and they were recording it word for word. And so what would happen is when they would actually open up the Old Testament, it had to exactly match for word for word. And so they would open up to the middle of it, and if it did not match that middle part of the word, they would take everything they had done, years of work, and they would burn it. They would throw it away. Because they believed so much that this was God's word that they had to have it exactly right, word for word and letter for letter. But before a great discovery, we could only trace it back to 1000 AD. And so there's a huge 1,000-year gap between the Old Testament of the Bible and the document that we actually had. So a lot of people said, well, wait a minute. How do we know in that 1,000 years things didn't change? How did we know that in 1,000 years that people didn't write a different message in it or change the words or just try to manipulate the people? The church has done that before. But then there was a great discovery that happened that we know today as the Dead Sea Scrolls. And what happened was a little Jewish boy was out throwing rocks into the caves and he heard a great smash. And he goes up there and he finds all of these clay pots. And within these clay pots are these ancient documents. And he made the greatest discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which actually dates back these documents to 200 to 400 years before Jesus Christ actually came. He found a 1,000-year period gap discovery of these documents. And when they began to actually analyze the Old Testament and compare it to the Old Testament that we have today, they came to the conclusion that it was 99.5% accurate. God sustains his word throughout the ages. They hid these Dead Sea Scrolls because when the church was actually being persecuted, they were afraid that they were going to burn these documents up. So they stuffed them in clay pots and hid them in the caverns. And so there's discoveries out there that we haven't even made yet of people who have been trying to sustain God's word and they've been hiding it for us to find and discover. And so those three things, just on the Bible alone, tell us that our Bible is more accurate than all these other philosophical documents. But you say, well, that doesn't prove anything. You're right, maybe it doesn't. But what about it's a supernatural document? Does God really sustain his word is the question we have. You say, okay, fine, you've proved that maybe it's a historical document. Maybe we can believe some of the things in the Bible, but does that mean that God actually wrote it? We know the Bible was written by people, and God worked within those people's lives, and he inspired them to write it. That's what Christians believe. But maybe it's just a historical document. Maybe it's just a book. How is the Bible different than any other book that we have? In 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, it says, "All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work." So if the Bible was actually God-breathed, if the Bible was actually inspired by God, written through man, it means that we can read it over and over and over again, and it will never get old. Why? Because the Holy Spirit that dwells within us will communicate the words off of the page into our spirit, and it will speak to us a different message every single time. Because it's no longer man who's communicating, it's the Holy Spirit that's communicating. He's communicating to us from this word that was written by God. That's what people believe. And you say, well, prove it. Well, something to prove it, I think, is all of the prophecies that have been fulfilled in the New Testament from the Old Testament. You see, we believe that God is one God who's worked throughout creation. I preached a series on order from chaos, which we went through the entire book of Genesis. And what I tell people is God created the world in 7 days. It took 2 chapters for people to mess it up. We get to chapter 3 and we see that people messed it up. And the rest of the entire Bible is God restoring his creation. That's what he does. He's trying to restore the relationship that we broke within the first 3 chapters of the Bible that we read in the book of Genesis. And so we see all of these prophecies in the Old Testament where God's making promises to his people over time that he's going to restore all things. And let me just run through some of them. And prophecy was a very important thing. You see, sometimes we get scared about prophecy because we talk about future prophecies and people walk around, and sometimes people get a little crazy with prophecy and they'll put their hands on you and say, "Oh, I prophesize that you're going to be a teacher." Well, that's not what I'm saying here. Okay? I don't believe that anybody has the gift to walk around and begin to tell you what you're going to be. If you're going to be something, then God's going to tell you himself. Okay? Through the work of the Holy Spirit. But prophecy was some things that God was actually giving the gift to people, and they would go and they would actually prophesize of what God's going to do in the future. It was a promise to the people what God was going to do, not for individual people, but about God. And so we see prophecy being a very important thing. In Isaiah 46, 9 and 10, it says, "Remember the former things long past, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is no one like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things which have not been done, saying, my purpose will be established and I will accomplish all of my good pleasure." And prophecy was very, very important. There's actually 1,239 prophecies in the Old Testament and 578 in the New Testament, for a total of 1,817 future predictions. In Deuteronomy 18, 20 and 22, it actually says, "But the prophet who speaks a word presumptuously in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or which he speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die." And so who wanted to be a prophet in that day? If you said one wrong thing, they would put you to death. And the way to test that is if you prophesy something and it didn't come true, then instantly they would kill you. So many times people have tried to predict when Jesus Christ is going to return. We believe that he ascended to heaven and one day he will return again and he will establish his kingdom here on earth. That's what he promises in his Lord's Prayer. That's what he taught his disciples. And so people have tried to predict that over time periods, and they've said, "Oh, Jesus is coming back here," or "Jesus is coming back here," or "the end of the world is, we thought it was Y2K in the year 2000. We thought it was 2011. We thought it was all of these different time periods that we've tried to predict, and yet we're still here. And so each of those people would be put to death if we base it off of the law of Deuteronomy. It says, "You may say in your heart, how will we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not come about or come true, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him, and you should put him to death." And so a couple different prophecies that talk about just the Lord Jesus Christ, that Jesus was God. We see in Isaiah 7:14. You should write these verses down. in his conception, it says, "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel." In Micah 5:2, it says, "But as for you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be a ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity." In Zechariah 11:12-13, it says, "I said to them, it is good, if it is good in your sight, give me your wages, but if it is not, never mind. So they weighed out 30 shekels of silver as my wages. Then the Lord said to me, throw it to the potter, that magnificent price at which I have valued by them. So I took the 30 shekels of silver and threw them to the potter in the house of Israel." Now, I don't know if this means anything to you, but as we talk about his conception, we believe in this Virgin Mary, that the Holy Spirit came on to Mary, and she was a virgin at the time. She was betrothed to Joseph. She was engaged to be married, and she was found with child. And so in Isaiah, in the Old Testament, it actually predicts that there is going to be a virgin in the New Testament that's going to have this son, and they're going to call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. In Micah 5:2, it's talking about his birth, that there's going to be one from the clans of Judah that's going to raise up. In Zechariah 11, it's talking about 30 pieces of silver. Well, if you know your Bible, you know that Jesus Christ was betrayed by Judas, and he collected 30 pieces of silver. And so all of these things from the Old Testament, it's talking about his death in Psalm 22:12-18, when it actually says, "Many bulls have surrounded me. Strong bulls of Bashan have encircled me. They open wide their mouth at me as a ravaging and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all of my bones are out of joint." Well, if you read how Jesus was actually tortured right before he died, they beat him. They whipped him. They bruised him. "My heart is like wax. It is melting within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my jaws as you lay me in the dust of death." He's talking about how thirsty he is. My tongue cleaves to my jaws. He needs water. Well, Jesus asked for something to drink, because as he was on the cross and he was bleeding so much and he was losing blood and he was actually bleeding to death, he became very, very thirsty, and he asked for something to drink, and they gave him wine vinegar, and he spit it out. "For dogs have surrounded me. A band of evildoers has encompassed me. They pierced my hands and my feet." We get a picture of the cross where Jesus is actually stretched out, and they put nails through his hands, and they put nails through his feet. "I can count all my bones. They look, they stare at me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Doesn't that sound like when Jesus was at the cross and the soldiers were right before him, and they began to actually cast lots for his garments, and they divided them up? This is years before, hundreds of years before the crucifixion, and it's being recorded right here about a future prediction. Let's talk about non-messianic prophecies that were fulfilled. There are over 1,800 other prophecies that didn't talk about Jesus that came about from actually being written down, and later we see the response to it. Talk about the city of Tyre in Ezekiel 26:3-5, 7, 12, 14, and 16. The city of Tyre, we're talking about 590 years before Jesus Christ. Let me take you there. And it says, "Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Tyre," talking about the city, "and I will bring up many nations against you. As the sea brings up its waves, they will destroy the walls of Tyre and break down her towers, and I will scrape her debris from her and make her a bare rock. She will be a place for the spreading of nets in the midst of the sea, for I have spoken, declares the Lord, and she will become spoil for the nations. For says the Lord God, behold, I bring upon Tyre from the north Nebuchadnezzar. He even names the king years before it happens. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, king of kings, with horses, chariots, cavalry, and a great army. Also, they will make a spoil of your riches and a prey of your merchandise. Break down your walls and destroy your pleasant houses and throw your stones and your timbers and your debris into the water. I will make a bare rock. You will be a place for the spreading of nets. You will be built no more, for I am the Lord who has spoken, declares the Lord of God. Then all the princes of the sea will go down from their thrones, remove their robes, and strip off their embroidered garments. They will clothe themselves with trembling. They will sit on the ground, tremble every moment, and be appalled at you. So he's talking about this prediction of what's going to happen to this city in the book of Ezekiel. And we see about seven things. Nebuchadnezzar will conquer Tyre, number one. Number two, other nations will take part in their destruction. Number three, Tyre will be flat like the top of a rock. Number four, Tyre will become a place to spread nets, it says. Number five, Tyre's stones and timber will be laid in the sea. Number six, other cities will fear because of Tyre's destruction. And number seven, Tyre will not be rebuilt. And we actually see this take place throughout history. And I'm not talking about the Bible. I'm talking about historical accounts who have written about what happened to the city of Tyre. Ezekiel tells us what happens is going to happen. But then we see other historical accounts that actually talk about it coming true. And so we see from Dr. Peter W. Stoner, who talks about in his book Science Speaks, he says, Tyre was a city on the northern coast of Palestine inhabited by the Phoenicians, a strong maritime people greatly feared by their enemies. The king of Tyre supplied timbers of Solomon in the building of the temple. In 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar, king of the Babylonians, laid siege in the city of Tyre. The siege lasted about 13 years, and when Nebuchadnezzar took the city in 573 BC, he found that the Phoenicians had moved everything of value to the island about 1/2 mile off the coast. Though the city was taken, Nebuchadnezzar profited nothing, and the Phoenicians were not conquered. Nebuchadnezzar could not pursue them in their island position, so he returned to Babylon. Thus, the first item of the prophecy was fulfilled. Nebuchadnezzar shall take the city of Tyre. It continues on and says, for 241 years, the mainland city of Tyre remained very much as Nebuchadnezzar left it. Later, Alexander, city great, started his great conquest. His field of campaign laid to the east, but he feared that the fleet of Tyre might be used against his homeland, so he moved south to take the city of Tyre. In 332 BC, Alexander reached Tyre, but he was unable to take the city at once. So he captured other coastal cities and took over their fleets. But with these combined fleets, he was still unable to take Tyre. Alexander finally built a causeway from the mainland to the island. In building the causeway, he used all the building materials of old Tyre, and that was not enough. He scraped up all of the soil and around the old city, and with it completed the causeway. After 7 months, by a combined attack of land forces marching in over the causeway and the fleets of the conquered city, he ended up taking Tyre. And this is where he begins to actually fulfill the other prophecies. Thus, items 2, 3, and 5 of the prophecies were fulfilled. Two other nations are to participate in the fulfilling of the prophecy. The city is made flat like the top of a rock as he overcame it. Its stones and timber are to be laid in the sea. Other neighboring cities were so frightened by the conquest of Tyre that they opened their gates to Alexander. If you read through history, you'll see that Alexander the Great continued to conquer cities at this point without oppositions and fulfilled other items. Other cities fear greatly at the fall of Tyre. And so Tyre was such a great city at that time that Alexander overcame it and began to fulfill prophecy after prophecy after prophecy after prophecy. It talks about the city of Tyre today, that people go to it, and what is it known for? It's known for its fishing. They will cast nets, and they never rebuilt that city. I could go on and on about it, but I'll go to my next point, because that's just about the Bible. That's just about the Bible. I got a few other points to make this morning. What about your experience? You know, people can fight against the Bible all day long, and they can say, well, I'm not going to believe the historical account. That doesn't prove anything. But what people cannot take away is your experience. As Saul was on that road, he saw a great light. As Saul was on the road, he heard a voice. And it says, "Why are you persecuting me?" And he says, "Who are you?" And he says, "I am Jesus." Nobody can take that away from Saul. And so Saul goes into the city of Damascus at that point. He was going to Damascus on the road to actually kill other Christians. And what happens is that Jesus flips Saul's life upside down. And Saul experiences Jesus firsthand and changes his life forever. He changes his name to Paul. And he becomes the greatest missionary the church has ever known, planting church in city after city after city for the rest of his life, and finally going to death in front of Caesar in order to proclaim the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Nobody can take that away from him. Nobody can take away your experience that you've had with God. When God changes your life, when he changes your heart, when he changes your motivations, when he changes your outlook on life, when he changes your attitude, he flips it upside down. In my own personal experience, I can tell you for the first 19 years of my life, I went to a Greek Orthodox church, very much like Catholic. And they would go through rituals and symbolisms, and I knew all about Jesus Christ, but I had never read the Bible and experienced Jesus Christ on the first hand. And so growing up, I went to church on a Sunday regular basis, but never opened up the Bible, never prayed, never spent time with Jesus, never talked to Jesus. I just knew and learned about him from Sunday school classes. Coming about the age of 19, I'd fallen into the habits of occasionally smoking marijuana. I'd fallen into the habits of actually spending time going out partying and spending time with friends and even got a girl pregnant when I was 16 years old. But at 19 years old, God grabbed a hold of my heart and he shook me. He shook me like a rag doll, and I experienced God firsthand. I began going to church with new eyes. I began to actually open up my Bible and read it. Chapter by chapter, I started right in the beginning of the book of Genesis and worked my way through. And after a 2-year period of time, I was ready to give my life to Jesus Christ. I surrendered my heart to Jesus. I went before the church. I made a profession of faith. I stood there and made my commitment to God. And that doesn't mean I walk perfectly, but then God began to show me what my purpose was in life, because before that experience, I had no purpose. My purpose was to find the next party, to find the next girl, and to have fun. That's what I was living for. I was living for myself. And so when people say, "Well, wait a minute, you can't prove to me that Jesus Christ was God," I said, "Yeah, right. I can't prove it for your life, but I can prove it for mine. Let me show you within my testimony what God has done for me." Because after that experience, God showed me what it was like to work in a church, and I became a youth pastor. God showed me what it was like to become a pastor. I experienced firsthand the joy in life of actually worshiping God without drugs. It was wonderful. I knew for the first time that I could come to church and I could raise my hands and praise and worship Jesus without being high, and I felt so good in my life that it felt a spiritual high. I knew I had overcome all my addictions with the power of Jesus Christ. I knew that God had done that for my life, and what I'm here to tell you this morning is that God can do it for you too. And nobody can take away your experience with God. It's the same thing for the disciples. If someone says, "I don't believe that God is real. I don't believe in the message of Jesus Christ." Well, why would someone die for a lie? Let me ask you that. All of the disciples actually gave up their lives for this message. In fact, it says that Peter was actually dipped in hot oil, tar, and he stayed alive. And so when they took him out and he was still alive, then they crucified him on the cross, and he felt that he was so unworthy to be crucified in the same manner of Jesus Christ that he was crucified upside down. Why would person after person after person continue to give their life if it was just a lie? But they actually experienced something. Jesus Christ, when he resurrected from the dead, it says that he was in the city and he spent 40 days with his disciples. Why? Because he wanted his disciples to actually see him, for them to know, for them to touch him, for them to actually see that this man was alive. And they could believe it with all of their hearts, and it began to make sense. Number 3 is the answered prayer that we receive. Nobody can take away the answered prayer that God gives to you. In Hebrews 4:12 it says, "Therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." You know, in our power groups, when we meet on a weekly basis, we pray. And we pray at the very end of them, and we spend about 20 minutes in prayer. And it's just so awesome because people started praying. Just they were so intimidated at first to begin praying. And they're like, "No, we don't want to tell you our junk. We don't want to tell you what we're going through. We don't want to tell you any of this." So everybody was kind of quiet. But a little bit over time, over the last year, people began to open up and pray more and more and more. And sometimes we've been praying for some prayers for 6 months. And you know what? God has answered 90% of the prayers that we have actually offered up to him. God doesn't always answer them with a yes. He doesn't always answer them right away. Sometimes he answers them with a yes. Sometimes he answers them with a no. And sometimes he says, "Just wait." But we've been praying for someone to get a job over and over again. And you know what? They got a job. We prayed for another person to get a better job. And we were praying and praying and praying. And they got a better job. We've actually prayed where somebody went to an Apple interview over 6 times within our power group. We were praying for 6 months. This time is going to be the time. And with perseverance and persistence, last week he began working at Apple on his 6th interview. Can you believe that? We've been praying and praying, and God just continues to answer prayers of healing, of restoration, of relationships coming together. Nobody can take away your answered prayer. Number 4 is creation. In Romans 1:20 it says, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse." What Paul is saying in here, remember, Saul becomes Paul and he writes to the church of Rome, and he begins to tell them is, when you look at all of creation, you can actually see God. When you look up at the stars, who created that? When you look up at the sun, who created that? When you look up at the moon, who created that? Who created? Yesterday, I was actually on a farm, and we were taking a tour with my family. And we went up there for the pumpkin patch, and we were getting pumpkins and doing all these things. And I was listening to what the guy was saying, and he says that 80% of the pollination actually comes from honeybees. Honeybees provides for 80% of what we have in this farm. That's how God created it. I thought, man, that is just amazing that God created the honeybee to actually pollinate our fruits and vegetables. And without that small little insect, we would be starving, because all of our food comes from him. You watch a child grown, you watch how children are made and created and all these things. It's unbelievable that people can actually see life take place and wonder, how is it possible that we don't have a God that's actually creating it behind the scenes? Everybody take out their phone. Y'all have phones with you? Everybody take out their phone. Hold it up. Now, how did you get your phone? AT&T. We bought it. We went to the store and we actually bought it, right? It would be ridiculous for us to think that that phone just showed up at that store. It would be ridiculous because we didn't see behind the scenes of it being put together. We didn't see behind the scenes of them actually drafting up the iPhone 6, the newest creation, and making improvements to it, and actually the truck that got shipped to the store. Because all we do is show up at the store and we experience the phone. So you know in your back of your mind that it would be ridiculous for you to go to the store and say, "Oh, it just appeared. It's just there. It's just there by chance, and I take it home." Because we don't see it. And what I'm here to tell you is, because things are working behind the scenes, we actually get to experience the graces of it. It's the same thing with God. God created, God enabled, God made. And just because we haven't seen all of that, but what we do see is we see the evidence of it. We see it with children. We see it with our bodies. We see it with nature. We see it with ourselves. We see the evidence of God's creation. And the number 5, the last point I want to make to you before we leave this morning, talking about why Christians stand up for what they believe, is the church. We're here to build a church, and that's exactly why the source has been created, because we want people to actually come and worship Jesus. Because in Matthew 16 it says, "I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. How is it that 2,000 years later after Jesus Christ, we can still say that the church of God is being built? How is it that churches continue to be planted? How is it that people continue to give their lives to Jesus Christ? At the end of this month, we're going to have a baptism service, and people are actually going to be baptized for the very first time. How is it that people still are experiencing the message of Jesus Christ and saying, yes, I want to sign up for that. I want to give my life to that. How is it that within the first 312 years of the existence of the church, that they had to have underground churches? They had to go into homes and they had to go into hiding. And they could not tell the Roman government that they were meeting because the Romans would actually come in and kill them. In fact, people would say, I want to be baptized. And they would go to the church and they would go to the priest. And the priest would say, you realize if I baptize you, by tonight I'll be doing your funeral. So this morning I'm going to baptize you, but in the evening you're going to be dead. And people would say, I don't care. Because if I die, I'm going to be with Jesus in heaven. I'm going to experience glory with God. So let them kill me. And they would actually give their lives over and become baptized. And the church grew. The Roman government stepped in and they tried to squish the church. And yet the church grew in persecution. In countries today like China, or you see ISIS, where they're actually beheading children with Christian children, and they're beheading them and they're putting their heads on poles. How is it when the government steps in and tries to persecute them, or terrorist groups try to step in and persecute them, the message of the gospel actually ends up growing, and more people end up giving their lives to Jesus? If there wasn't a Holy Spirit working this all out behind the scenes, why would anybody sign up for that? And so people can fight us on the historical document of this Bible. They can fight us on the historical message, but we got proof. It's not insane to believe that this is actually true. We got historical proof that points to it. We got prophecies that have been fulfilled that have been pointed to it, and that's what testimony is. We got life experience of people standing up and confessing that, yes, God has changed my life. We got a whole entire prayers being answered by person after person if they honestly give it up to God. And we have a church that continues to grow and be built despite whatever comes against it, despite the troubles, despite the persecutions. And so when someone actually tells you that God does not exist or God is not real, you can look it up and say on a very factual, apologetic account that yes, God is real, that he is true, and he does exist today. In fact, I just want to play a short little clip before we pray from the movie God's Not Dead, if we have it there.
No. Put our bags in the trunk first. David, we spent our entire lives talking about faith. Now I'm asking you to show faith.
Okay. Unbelievable.
No. Faith.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
I don't even know what I'm doing here. I mean, it's not like you even know who I am.
You prayed and believed your whole life. Never done anything wrong. And here you are.
You're the nicest person I know. I am the meanest. You have dementia. My life is perfect. Explain that to me.
Sometimes the devil allows people to live a life free of trouble because he doesn't want them turning to God. Your sin is like a jail cell, except it's all nice and comfy and there doesn't seem to be any need to leave. The door is wide open. Till one day, time runs out. The cell door slams shut. And suddenly, it's too late. Who did you say you were?
Let's bow our heads. Father, we come before you and honor and worship you this morning. And Father, sometimes we have our own doubts when things don't go the way that we think they should. We see a world that's not perfect and it's very broken. We also experience troubles and have feelings of anger because things don't go the way that we expect. Father, there are people that doubt you in our world. We have a message ringing in our ear of Satan, the evil one, that continually tells us that you're not there for us, that you don't care, or you don't even exist at all. Is this all fake? Sometimes we wonder in our minds. And Father, there's a whole world, even if we firmly believe in you, that still doesn't. And sometimes we question, how can we see things so clearly and them not see things at all? Father, this morning we pray for faith. We pray for faith as we've studied the historical account to say that, yes, there is proof that your Bible is historically accurate and true. As we have faith, Lord, we ask for the eyes to see what other people's don't, that you actually have accomplished your predictions, your promises that you've given in your scripture to show us as proof that your Bible is true. When we can look at evidences in archaeology, we can look at evidences in astronomy, and we can see in science that it all points back to you. Even though there's so many that say that science disproves you, we see that no, you are for science, and that science points back to you when we study it. We can make a case for it. And Father, we can make a case how you've intervened in our own lives. And if you haven't intervened in someone's life this morning, if they've been practicing tradition and ritual and just showing up to church like I did for the first 19 years of my life, and Father, we can often backslide and just slide away from church altogether, and we've just never had a real relationship with you. We've known what it's like to learn about you, but we've never actually experienced you. I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit intervenes in their life right now. May they feel your presence. May they want to commit to you. May they want to surrender their lives to you. May we want to come before you and lay our lives before you and say it's better with you. Help us go into relationship. Father, I pray for all the unanswered prayers in this room. You know the prayers of each of our hearts. And we can offer them all up to you. And right now, Lord, you're listening. Your ear is bent toward us. You do listen to us. Father, hear our prayers as we offer them to you. And Father, we come before you this morning and we just ask that you continue to build your church. Continue to grow your church so the gospel message of Jesus Christ can be spread throughout the entire city of Pembroke Pines and even beyond it. To Hialeah, to Fort Lauderdale, Lord, to West Palm Beach, Lord, continue to grow your church through the whole state of Florida, Lord. Continue to grow your church in the U.S. Continue to grow your church in those countries where persecution is happening. Continue to defend us from the evil one that wants to come against us and snuff out your church. Give us the ability to speak your message, Lord, of Jesus Christ, to have the faith to actually share it with others. Help us to speak. Help us to take a stand. Help us to continue to commit to you. We pray this all in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.